run into my kids that I've had the previous years, and I'm like, oh my gosh, how have you been? And they ignore me. Welcome back to my channel. I am so excited to be doing another video for you guys, and on today's video is gonna be about 10 things that I wish I would have known before I became a teacher. These things are not, let's say, positive. Most of these things are not positive, because they're just things, I'm just being raw and honest with you guys, they're just things that people don't warn you about before being a teacher. So these are not things to make you second guess your career, by no means. I love teaching, I love being a teacher, but I think it is beneficial to hear some of the things that you need to know before you start teaching, or that you weren't aware of. So anyways, without further ado, I hope that you like this video. Please don't forget to give it a big thumbs up if you like it. And if you are brand new here to my channel, please don't forget to subscribe as well. Okay guys, so the number one thing that you should know before being a teacher is that you're gonna learn to become a pro at holding your bladder, and that's not necessarily a good thing. I know it sounds funny, but it's actually a very serious problem, and that's because whenever you're a teacher, you can't just leave your class to go to the restroom, and if you do, I mean, it's up to you. Some teachers do. I do it sometimes if it's an emergency, but I've learned to hold it for a long time. Honestly, if this was a skill, I would probably be one of the top 10 or something like that. No, but in all seriousness, you should know that you need to hold it, or that you need to kind of plan ahead so that you don't need to use the restroom while you are teaching, because it's really hard to leave your students by themselves. And sometimes I've done that. Sometimes I sneak out of the room without them even knowing, because I know as soon as they find out I'm gone, they will cause problems. So sometimes, like, if they're reading and no one is paying attention to me, I'll just like slip out of the room and then go quickly. Now for me, it's awesome, because it's handy, because I'm literally right next to the bathrooms. Like, the bathrooms are catty corner from my classroom, but that doesn't work with all of the teachers. And then also, it's just, I don't know, it's just something that you have to keep in mind. But once you get experience, then you will know when to go, like, you know, for example, when to take advantage of that free time that you have to go run to the restroom really quick and then come back. Another thing, number two, that you should know before becoming a teacher is that you will cry, for sure. And this is mostly just for I guess it's for any teacher really, but especially if you are a first year teacher, you are gonna cry. If you're anything like me, you're gonna cry. And I'm not saying it to scare you or anything, it's just a lot of people don't prepare you for what teaching is actually about, or everything that you're gonna face when you become a teacher, or when you're starting to be a teacher, because there's so much stress. And you guys, I went through so much stress my first year teaching, because I was teaching 5th and 6th grade and I had no experience whatsoever, like not even student teaching experience. That's actually another story for another day if you guys want to hear. It's pretty crazy. But anyways, I didn't have any experience whatsoever. I was just thrown into the wolves, and I became pretty overwhelmed, like really, really easy. And you know, 5th and 6th graders is no joke, you guys. Like, they are a hard group of kids, especially when you are as young as I was when I started teaching, which was at 21. I did take an advice from someone, I forgot who it was, but they said, if you have to cry, at least don't do it in front of your kids. And that advice was very helpful for me, because first of all, that's just, you're showing that you're vulnerable. And so if you cry in front of your students, you know, some of them might give you sympathy and might be nice, but others might like laugh at you, or like get you, like they'll know like what your weak point is, and they'll know that you'll break down, you know? So like, if you do it once, you're gonna be prone to do it again and again and again. And that's just not, it just doesn't look very professional. So if you have to cry, just try to do it somewhere where your students can't see. The number three thing that I wish I knew before becoming a teacher is that you're gonna have to ask your students for forgiveness. And this is something that I had never thought about, but over time, you're gonna make mistakes, obviously. Like, we're human, you're gonna make mistakes, but there's gonna be times when there's gonna be a really hard pill to swallow when you mess up and you don't wanna face it, or where you just don't wanna be ridiculed and in front of your students, you know? But pretty much you're gonna have to learn to ask for forgiveness if you mess up, and not just in front of one student, but in front of the whole class. And that was a very humbling moment for me when I first did it. I've done it a few times ever since I started teaching, because I mess up again. But one time I remember, oh my gosh, I was so mad. I just like flat out yelled at all of the students, and I had never even like realized that I could yell, like, you know, like as a teacher, like that I could actually be mean or whatever. And so it took some time to realize, and then afterwards I felt so bad, and I was just like, you guys, I think it was like the next day or so, and I was like, you guys, I have to ask you guys for forgiveness. And honestly, it felt so good to do it. And also, kids have a huge heart, so most of the time they're gonna forgive you unless you did something that's just like really terrible. But for the most part, no, they were really nice and everything. But it definitely is a humbling moment, because I mean, who would have thought, you know, the teacher having to ask for forgiveness with their students? It just doesn't sound right. But yeah, I mean, you have to learn from your mistakes, and you have to face your mistakes sometimes. So definitely know that there is gonna come a time when you're gonna have to ask for forgiveness, and that's okay. So advice number four, I believe, I can't even count anymore. Anyways, my next advice is, well, not really advice, but things that you should know, is that hand sanitizer is gonna become your best friend, especially if you are an elementary teacher. And I know this sounds silly to say, but it's definitely, like, literally, it's gonna become your best friend. And because kids are germy, kids have a lot of germs and they spread bacteria like crazy. And if you don't put hand sanitizer on, or have them put hand sanitizer on, soon enough there's gonna be a whole class full of you know, viruses and sicknesses and things like that. So you want to try to avoid that as much as possible. I love when my kids give me hugs and stuff, but I do try to keep hand sanitizer handy for both them and myself, because again, it's not easy. They can be sticky, slimy, and all the above. So yes, just make sure you know that you should have hand sanitizer handy in your classroom, and hopefully you never run out, because that's just terrible. Okay, so the next thing that I struggled with that I didn't really realize until about my second year of teaching is that you have to learn how to leave work at work. And as a first year teacher, oh my gosh, I was like, how in the world can I do this? Like, literally, I would get out of work, I would go home, like cook, you know, do my thing, and then I still had like 2 or 3 hours of like planning and organizing and grading, and I became so overwhelmed so easy, and I literally just burnt out right away, you know? And it just took a lot of trial and error for me to just finally realize, like, okay, like, I can't do everything at once, and I need to really prioritize my time, and some things don't have to get done at that moment. And so for me, that was really hard. But definitely, you guys, my biggest advice is for you guys to leave work at work. Don't try to bring it home with you. I mean, unless you have to, and if you have to, just time yourself, like, give yourself like 30 minutes to an hour, and then after that, like, step back, step away from that. Otherwise, it's gonna be something that's very draining, that you kind of like are not looking forward to. The next one for me hit me very quickly when I became a teacher, and that is that some students are gonna need you to act as a parent, as a friend, as a counselor. Like, you know, like, you're not just a teacher to them. Like, you are there, you can be there as their friend, even their their older sister or whatever. Like, some students are gonna go through a lot and they just need someone to hear them out. And you're gonna have those times when you're just like, wow, like, that's crazy, you know, like, my student just poured out their whole heart to me and I didn't need to know about that, but they are gonna share things with you that they've never shared with anyone else, and you need to be prepared for that. And also, I mean, obviously if they're in harm you need to tell someone, but also you need to keep it confidential because they trust in you, and that's huge. As a kid, trusting in their teacher is huge because they probably don't trust anyone like at home. And so that's very, I don't know, like, that's very awesome that students can have teachers to trust. But if you break their trust, then it's just gonna be very damaging for the student and your relationship with them. And so I just advise you just to always remember that you can be someone to hear a student out when they're going through something, and you can just be their parent if they need advice on something. And that to me was, again, it hit me really hard and very fast because I was a fifth and sixth grade teacher, and fifth and sixth graders go through a lot. So, because, you know, they're at that like preteen stage. Another thing as a teacher is that you have to learn how to leave your personal life at home, or, you know, like, as soon as you walk in the door, you have to leave all of that stuff behind. And that is really hard, honestly, but you have to pretty much be an actor, like, as a teacher in front of your kids, because you can't bring your problems to your classroom and be a good teacher and be there for your students and succeed in your career, because, I mean, those things will just drag you down. So you have to definitely just leave everything behind that you've been dealing with at home or in your personal life, and just leave it behind. Don't even, you know, like, ponder on it until after you get out of work, because if you do that, that's just not gonna be beneficial for the kids. And again, you're not gonna be the best that you can for them. And kids, I mean, as hard as this sounds, like, kids don't really care all of that much about your personal life. Like, they're just there to learn, and they don't really even think of you as having a personal life outside of school. Like, they just see, for some reason they just see teachers as teachers. Okay, number eight is that teacher pays suck. And I'm just saying this because I'm being honest, but you guys, I started, like, when I first started with my career as a teacher, I was, like, you know, going from, like, nothing to, like, going to, like, from nothing to a teacher salary. I was like, okay, like, yeah, I'm banking, you know. But pretty soon I realized, like, wow, this money does not last at all. So yeah, teacher pay sucks. So if you are a teacher for the money, like, honey, you're in the wrong career. So just know that in order to be a teacher, or for you to succeed as a teacher, you have to do it out of passion for teaching, for to change kids' lives, because no one ever, I mean, maybe in big cities and, I don't know, private schools, I don't know, maybe you will get paid good as a teacher. But even then, you guys, like, I know friends that make like 20,000, 30,000, 40,000 more than I do just because of their careers. And it's crazy because their careers seem a lot less demanding, and it's insane. But then again, like, because I love it so much, like, I don't really care about all of that. Like, yes, do I wish I had a better pay? Like, obviously, but that's not gonna change my career. That's not gonna change my passion. And so hopefully that doesn't change yours either, but just be aware that teacher pay sucks. Number nine is probably the worst one, and this is when, like, I run into my kids that I've had the previous years, and I'm like, oh my gosh, how have you been? And they ignore me. Yeah, I mean, it's hard truth. Some students will ignore you. Even if you had a great freaking relationship, when you have them in class, yeah, sometimes they're gonna pretend that you're not even there, that they've never even met you before, but it's gonna hurt. But you know, hopefully once they graduate or before they graduate, they'll send you an invite and they'll say, sorry miss, and then hug it out, and hopefully it'll be all good. But just so you know, it's bound to happen. And the very last thing, you guys, that I want to leave you guys with is that as a teacher, you have to remind yourself of your passion, of why you started this career and who you're doing it for. You're doing it not just for yourself, but you're doing it and you're doing it to change kids' lives and so many people's lives, you guys. Like, you can impact so many people, so many kids, and it really depends on you, on how they see life and how they see their education and how they value things in life. And I know it's a lot of pressure, but you guys, just keep reminding yourself, like, why you started, and just remind yourself of that passion, like, over and over again, and that will just be, I don't know, it helps your career just be more rewarding and just have a better just a better time. Like, you set the tone every day when you walk into your classroom, you set the tone every day. If you want to be happy, if you want to be grumpy, like, your students are constantly going to feed off of that, and you just need to know and realize that. And so yeah, that's all of the 10 things that I wish I knew before becoming a teacher, and I hope that helped you guys. I was very excited to be filming this video, and I hope it made sense. So yeah, thank you guys so much for watching. I will see you guys in my next video, and until next time, bye guys.